Hello, I'm Reverend Sam, and I'm your host on The Secret of Glory and Power. This program is targeted at giving you stories about men and women who went from adversity to prosperity, who went from despair to victory, with just one intention, so that you and I can learn from their mistakes, so that you and I can learn from their steps of wisdom, so that we also can get to that place where God has ordained for each of us to get to. I believe that everyone watching me is born with glory. There's something in your life, there's a gift embedded in you that is capable of transforming your destiny and transforming the destiny of your children yet unborn. But you know, the point is this: if you do not know how to work with the principles of success, you may have so much potential and yet die a debtor. We are told about the story of a wise poor man who, through his wisdom, he was able to deliver a small city from a big city, and yet he remained poor. I mean, that's not good, because wisdom is supposed to fill your house with all manner of treasure. But it is because this person does not know how to operate the spirit of wisdom. That's why, though he's rich, but yet he's poor. It's a contradictory combination. And some of us are out there watching me right now. You have the same potential. You have potential for greatness, but nothing is working for you. You have prayed against every enemy, yet there's no way forward. You know why? Because after you pray, you need to know what to do. And that's what this program is meant for, to show you steps to take and how to go about succeeding in life. Now, sometimes ago, I started a series on the richest man in Babylon. Now, why do I pick this book to go through this series? The book consists of stories of about four or five different people who came from poverty to riches. And, you know, the book was written in 1926. That is to tell you that I'm talking about ancient wisdom. Wisdom that has been tried. Wisdom that has been used. Wisdom that has been proved and has worked for many, many people. Now, when I first read this book about 30 years ago, I was so thrilled and captivated by the content that I began to practice it. Within 4 years, I proved that everything written in this book is real. Apart from that, as a senior pastor of our ministry, I actually developed a teaching series from these books that we taught in our church for 2.5 years. A few of our people who put these secrets to use, today, they are far better in terms of business, in terms of prosperity, in terms of awareness about the secret of life. Now, and I just felt that I should share some of this secret with you so that you too can be a partaker of what I have known that has changed my life, what many people have known over centuries that has changed their life. Now, I am coming to the second person, because we did the first person in the last few episodes. Now, I'm coming to the second person. Now, it's a book, so I'll be reading and I'll be explaining. And when I finish today, next session, by the grace of God, I will continue from wherever I stop today. But I want you to open up your heart, because you see, it's like when a coach is trying to coach his athletes. It's not interesting, but that's where they get the secret that make them to be celebrated when they finally go for the competition. These are the secrets that we make men to celebrate with time to come. So don't sway your mind. Don't change the channel. Something good is coming your way. Seven cure for a lean pulse. That is the title of this second chapter. When the good king Sargon returned from Babylon after defeating his enemies, the Elamites, he was confronted with a serious situation. The royal chancellor explained it to the king this way: after many years of great prosperity brought to our people because your majesty built the great irrigation canal and the mighty temples of the gods, now that these works are completed, the people seem unable to support themselves. The laborers are without employment. The merchants have few customers. The farmers are unable to sell their produce. The people have not enough gold to buy. You know that when a construction is taking place, so many people are employed. And as they are working there, they are getting their daily pay. So this chancellor was telling the king that, king, not quite long ago, you built a massive irrigation. And then you built temples. And there was a lot of gold that came from the treasury of the government into the hand of the people. And people became so rich because they were working and collecting money every day. But not long after that, it looks like all the money has vanished. We don't know what has happened. Merchants cannot, they don't have customers to buy things from them again. People are poor now. Where has all the money gone to? Now, but where has all the gold gone that we spent for this great improvement? Demanded the king. It has found its way, I fear, responded to the chancellor, into the possession of a few very rich men of our city. It filtered through the fingers of most of our people as quickly as the goat's milk got through the strainer. Now that the stream of gold has ceased to flow, most of our people have nothing to show for their earnings. Do you get that? That's why the thing has not disappeared. The money came through their hand, yes, but somehow the money came through their hand and left their hand. You know, one day, long ago, I was listening to a radio show. And then this guy said, he said that somebody said, when we gather all the currency of the whole world, including gold, diamond, and put it in a common purse, and split the money and everything in equal proportion to everybody on earth, he said it has been proved that with time, money will leave the hand of the poor and go back to the hand of the rich. That means it's only a matter of time. When someone is poor, even if he gets opportunity for riches, that money will still leave his hand. Guess to where? To those who know how to manage money, how to use money, how to increase money. And that's what has happened to these people. They had great money coming in. Everybody for a time was marrying and everything like that. But after a while, it ceased because the money came into their hand and left their hand into the hand of few rich people. And I believe that God has ordained that you and I should be among that few rich people that wealth will be coming to our life. But you need to know how it happens. It's not just by prayer. It's not just by fasting. Have you ever noticed? God has never asked us to pray about money. He has never asked us to fast about money. Why? Because there are established principles that God wants you and I to know, so that by putting these things to use, we can accumulate wealth, increase riches, and be a blessing to our generation. Abraham is our father. And it's our example. Let's go ahead. The king was thoughtful for some time. Then he asked, why should so few men be able to acquire all the gold? Because they know how, replied the chancellor. One may not condemn a man for succeeding because he know how. Neither may one with justice take away from a man what he has fairly earned to give to men of less ability. But why, demanded the king, should not all the people learn how to accumulate gold and themselves become rich and prosperous? Quite possible, Your Excellency. But who can teach them? Certainly not the priest, because they know not how to make money. Who knows best in all our city how to become wealthy, Chancellor? Asked the king. Your question answer itself, Your Majesty. Who has amassed the greatest wealth in Babylon? Well said, my able chancellor. It is Akkad, the richest man in Babylon. Bring him before me tomorrow. Upon the following day, as the king has decreed, Akkad appeared before him, straight and spreadly, despite his 70 years. Akkad, spoke the king, is it true that thou art the richest man in Babylon? So it is reported, Your Majesty, and no man disputes it. How became thou so wealthy? Then he answered, by taking advantage of opportunity available to all citizens of our good city. Thou hast nothing to start with. That is the king's question. Akkad said, only a great desire for wealth. Besides this, I have nothing. Akkad, continued the king, our city is in a very unhappy state because a few men know how to acquire wealth. Therefore, monopolize it. While the mass of our citizens lack the knowledge of how to keep any part of the gold they receive. It is my desire that Babylon be the wealthiest city in the world. Therefore, it must be a city of many wealthy men.
Therefore, we must teach all the people how to acquire riches. Tell me, Akkad, is there any secret to acquiring wealth? Can it be taught? It is practical, Your Majesty. That which one man know can be taught to others. The king's eyes glowed. Akkad, thou speak the words I wish to hear. Will you lend yourself to this great cause? Without teach thy knowledge to a school of for teachers? Sorry, will you teach thy knowledge to a school for teachers? Each of whom shall teach others until there are enough trained to teach each truth to every worthy subject in my domain. Akkad bowed and said, I am your humble servant to command. Whatever knowledge I possess, will I gladly give for the betterment of my fellow men and the glory of my king. Let your good chancellor arrange for me a class of 100 men, and I will teach to them those 7 cures which did fatten my pulse, than which there are none leaner in all Babylon. In other words, Akkad is saying, at a particular time, I was the poorest of the poor. But I will teach the secret that make me rich. Now, behold, the richest man a fortnight later, in compliance with the king's command, the chosen 100 assembled in the great hall of the temple of learning, seated upon colorful rings in a semicircle. Akkad sat beside a small tabard upon which smoked a sacred lamp, sending forth a strange and pleasing odor. Behold, the richest man in Babylon, whispered a student, nudging his neighbor as Akkad arose. He is but a man, even as the rest of us, and a dutiful subject of our great king. Akkad began, I stand before you in his service, because once I was a poor youth who did greatly desire gold, but because I found knowledge that enabled me to acquire it, he asked that I should impart unto you my knowledge. I started my fortune in the humblest way. I had no advantage nor enjoyed as fully by you and every citizen in Babylon. The first storehouse of my treasure was a well purse. In other words, well purse. It was an empty one. I desired it be full, clicking with the sound of gold. Therefore, I sought every remedy for a lean purse. I found 7. To you who are assembled before me, shall I explain the 7 cure for a lean purse, which I do recommend to all men who desire prosperity. Each day for 7 days, I will explain to you one of the 7 remedies. Listen attentively to the knowledge that I will impart. Debate it with me. Discuss it among yourselves. Learn these lessons thoroughly, that you may also plant in your own purse the seed of wealth. First, must each of you start wisely to build a fortune of your own. Then, will thou be competent, and only then, to teach this truth to others. What did the man say? The man said, don't be too quick to be a teacher. Don't come to this hall of learning to jot things down to go and teach other people. He said, no, I want you to come here. I want you to debate with me. Ask questions. Let's argue together. And after you are satisfied with the answers, first of all, go and put the truth to use by yourself. One of the problems we have is that we have many uneducated rich men. Many of them stole money through so many corrupt means. Some people embezzled money, and that's why they don't know how to manage it. Have you noticed that we are told that over 99% of those who win jackpot, who win lotto, in less than 10 years, they go back to penury? You know why? Because the riches came suddenly. The Bible says, anyone that gets riches suddenly, the riches will disappear. But he that gather and multiply it will keep increasing. That's what this man is telling them. He said, don't come here just to learn and go and teach others. Come here and learn. Learn what I teach you. Put it to use. When you have succeeded in putting it to use in your life, then you can teach others. And I'm glad to let you know that I put this thing to use for many years up to now, and it's working for me. So I can talk about these things with confidence, with conviction, because I put them to use. Now, the first lesson, start your purse to fatten. That's the first lesson. Akkad had said a thoughtful man in the second row Now listen to the first lesson. My good friend, of what craft work do you do? In other words, what's your job? The man replied, I am a scribe. I carve record upon the clay tablet. Even at such labor, did I myself earn my first copper? Akan was telling, you know, Akan's story was the one I told before. Akan was now telling him. He said that was the same work I was doing when I earned my first copper. Therefore, thou hast the same opportunity to build a fortune because you are earning money. He spoke to a frowned-faced man farther back. Please, tell also what you do to earn bread. I, responded the man, I am a meat butcher. I do buy goats the farmers raise and kill them and sell the meat to the housewives and the hides to the sandal makers. Because thou do also labor and earn, thou hast every advantage to succeed that I did. Now, in the same way, I can proceed to find how each labored to earn their living. When he had done questioning them, he said, now, my students, you can see that there are many trades and labor at which man may earn coins. Each of the ways of earning is a stream of gold from which the worker does divert by his labor a portion to his own purse. Therefore, into the purse of each of you flows a stream of coin, large or small, according to his ability. Is that not so? Thereupon they agreed that it was so. Then, continued Akkad, each of you desire to build a fortune for himself. Is it not wise to start by utilizing that source of wealth which he has established? To this they all agree. What is he saying? He's saying that if you want to build wealth, don't go and start looking for uncle to give you $1 million, $10,000. Start from what you earn. It may look a bit slow. I have been there. But the truth is, when you start from what you earn, you will be confident when the wealth begins to increase that God has helped you and you can teach others also. Now, then Akan turned to a humble man who had declared himself as egg merchant. If thou select one of thy basket and put into each morning 10 eggs and take out from each evening 9 eggs, what will eventually happen? It will become in time overflowing. You know what he said? One man was selling eggs. He said, okay, let me use it as an example. Just put a basket and put 10 eggs in it every morning and every evening take away 9 eggs. He now said, after a while, what will happen to the basket and the egg? The man said, there'll be a lot of eggs in that basket. Why? Because each day I put in one more egg than I take out. Akkad turned to the class with a smile. Does any man here have a lean purse? In other words, is your account empty? First, they look amused. Then they laugh. Lastly, they wave their purse in jest. All right, he continued. Now I shall tell thee the first remedy I learned to cure a lean purse, empty bank account. Do exactly as I've suggested to the egg merchant. For every 10 coin that thou place into thy purse, take out for use only 9. When you earn 10 coins, spend only 9. He continued. Do exactly for every 10 coin that thou place in thy purse, take out for use only 9. Your purse will start to fatten at once, and its increasing weight will feel good in your hand and bring satisfaction to your soul. Deride not what I say because of its simplicity. In other words, don't say, this is too simple. Truth is always simple. I told thee I will tell how I built my fortune. This was my beginning. I too carried empty account, lean purse, and cursed it because there was nothing within it to satisfy my desire. But when I began to take out from my purse but 9th part of 10 I put in, it began to fatten. So will yours. In other words, when I put $10, when I collect salary, $10, what I take out is not the $10. I don't spend all the money. I take out $9 I leave one-tenth. When I collect $100 in my check, when I want to spend, I don't spend all the hundred. I put $10. I take only one night. That's what the guy is trying to say. I'm just trying to explain to you. Now I will tell you a strange truth. The reason for which I know not. When I cease to pay out more than 1/9 of my earning, I managed to get along just as well. I was not shorter than before. Also, after a long time, did my coin come to me more easily than before? Surely, it is a law of the gods that unto him that keepeth and spend not a certain part of all his earnings shall gold come more easily. Likewise, him whose purse is empty does gold avoid. Which desire thou the most? Is it the gratification of your desire of each day, a jewel, a bit of finery, fine raiment, more food, things quickly gone and forgotten, or is it substantially belonging? Gold, land, hearts, merchandise, income bringing investments, the coin that thou take from thy purse, bring the first. The coin that thou leave within thy purse will bring you the later. What is he trying to say? He said, are you the type of person that like to eat? You want to buy clothes, fine clothes, better raiment, more food. He said, if you are the type that have that, he said, the 1/9 that you take out, use it for those ones. He said, the 1/10 that you keep, use it for land. Use it to buy gold, hearts, merchandise, income bringing investment. This, my student, was the first cure I did discover for my limpus. For each 10 coin I put in, I spent but 9. Debate this among yourself. If any man prove it untrue, tell me upon tomorrow when we shall meet again. Let's stop here. The man said when he first started practicing, putting 1/10 of his income in his account, he will not spend everything. He will put 1/10 there, he will only spend 9/10. He said, at first, it looks difficult, but after a while, he's able to get by. He just discovered that it's not difficult for him to leave 1/10 there. And then the 1/10 is living there, began to grow. Now, do you know, my people, that if you keep 1/10 of your salary every month, in 1 year, what are you going to have? In 1 year, you are going to have 1 month's salary in savings. If your salary is $5,000 and you are taking $4,500 out, you leave $500 there, in 12 months, you will have the salary of 1 month. Is that not? 1/10, when you keep it, it becomes an investment over time. And this is what this man said he did. If you don't have this, if you have not watched the previous episodes, I'm sorry, there's nothing I can do about that. But this man also came from abject poverty. He had 3 friends. 2 of them continued to just labor. He decided he was going to be rich, and God gave him opportunity, and he became rich. And now he's teaching others how to be rich. And out of the wisdom that he taught them in the early 90s, in 1926, I am giving you the same wisdom, that if only you can make up your mind that you not allow your bill to take everything away from you, if you will not allow the things that you are buying, you want to buy clothes, as you be, you want to go for party, you don't want them to see you use the same wristwatch every time, you want to keep changing your shoe, if you allow that to push you, you will remain in poverty. You'll be earning money but spending everything. But if you can discipline yourself, that no matter what happens, 1/10 of what you have, you are going to keep. It will only take some time. But I'm telling you that in 10 years, you will have had minimum of 1 year savings, 1 year salary. If your month salary is 5,000, that means in 1 year, you are earning 60,000. Is that not? Now, in 10 years, you will have minimum of $60,000 in your account. I call it minimum because as we continue to understand and put the principle to use, you will discover that you will have more than $60,000 after 10 years because your money that you are investing will begin to bring profit, and the profit that your money bring will also bring profit, and your money and the profit that it bring and the profit that that one bring will also bring you profit, and then you begin to have chains of income. So that before you die, before you leave this present world, you can be sure that you have left heritage for your children. These principles, what I will advise you is learn it, practice it for 10 years, and start teaching your children to do the same thing. So that after you are gone, they can take advantage of your wisdom. Akkad got rich. But the man that taught him this wisdom, his own children were not ready to learn. They were not ready to learn. But he was ready to learn. And the man made him a partner while he was alive. And when the man died, in his will, he gave him a good portion of his income. My desire to God is that you will prosper. My desire to God is that you will move from abject poverty to prosperity. It doesn't matter how much you are earning today. If you are an employee, you can be sacked. And the truth is that the money you have in the bank account will diminish if you don't know how to make money and how to make your money work for you. I've got to go right now. I'm going to continue this particular episode next time. And I'm trusting the Lord God Almighty that this wisdom that God is using to give you, which I have put to use myself, I'm praying to God that it will prosper you too, that you will learn from it, and that your life will be better. In the name of Jesus. If you have questions, I'll be glad to answer your questions. You can send your questions to the email on the screen, or you can send your questions to the number on the screen, and I will take time to answer you, because my desire is that somebody's life will become bettered because you watch this program. Because the reason why God asked me to put this program on air is so that your glory can shine and the power that God has given to you can be brought to effective use. I've got to go right now. But one thing that you can also do is that you can choose to put your advert on this program. You can support us so that we will keep having the opportunity of blessing many people. And as you are supporting us, you are tapping into the anointing of God on my life, which will give you the blessing that brings riches. I'll see you next time. I'm Reverend Sam, your host on The Secret of Glory and Power. God bless you. Bye-bye.